Yeah. This Newark Radio. And I am the host, the legendary Magic, with my big bro, Sutan, in the building. Say what up to the people, and this is Newark Radio, so.
What up, people? What's going on?
Yeah, man. First of all, I'd like to thank you for coming by. I know you had the other engagements, but you know what I'm saying? Just like the brother that you is, you always put people first before yourself. You know what I'm saying? So I'd like to thank you for coming by and doing this little interview with me. Sutan.
Yes, sir.
What part of Newark you grew up at?
Central Ward, Hayes Homes Project.
Central Ward, Hayes Homes Project.
Hayes Homes Project.
Yeah.
3-way West Kinney Street.
Oh, 3-way. What schools, elementary schools? You went to schools in Newark?
I went to Cleveland Elementary, West Kinney Junior High, and I have a dual high school package, Central and Weekway.
Central.
I attended both high schools, went to both proms, but I actually got my diploma from Weekway High School.
Oh, you did both proms? Oh, you was a man. So, I like to, before we start this interview, I want to do the protocol like I always do. You know, I want to give a strong shout out to the Honorable Mayor Roz Baraka, Mitty Baraka, Obalaji, the whole Baraka family, moving the city in the right direction, like I always say. You know what I'm saying? And speaking of the mayor, Sutan, I mean, this is what I think. I think you've been the longest supporter of the mayor for that anybody that I know of in Newark.
Well, I don't know about the longest.
Outside his family, you know what I'm saying? Outside his family, you know, that's a norm. But I think you've been the long supporter of the mayor.
Well, I've been around a long time since 1994, when he first ran for mayor. When he was 24 years old, I was there, and I'm still there now, along with a few others.
Oh, okay. But I'm just saying, in my eyes, that's why I say, I know there's others around, but in my eyes, I seen you. So 1994, I mean, he ran, and you was with him when he ran up against some powerhouses, like,
He ran up against Sharp James. He was 24, fresh out of college. And we did it. We got 10% of the votes with little or no money. Uh-huh. And 20 years later, he came back and, you know, history.
See, that's what I'm saying. Like, what did you see in our mayor back then at 24 years old? See, people know Roz now. You know what I'm saying? But for you to support this brother, you know what I'm saying, at 24, going up against a strong political power such as Sharp James and Donald Bradley, like, them was powerhouses in our community. So what you seen in our mayor that said, yo, he got it? You seen that back then?
Well, I mean, I think he just had a clear message. You know, he was very focused and very clear, and he wanted to see a change in our city. It was time. And young people wasn't engaged in local politics as they are now. You know, I think he is a catalyst. He started young people to really get engaged and get involved in local politics. And he was just clear. He was just determined. And, you know, his thing was, he came home from college and people couldn't get jobs. They couldn't find a place in politics. So he said, hey, well, I'm going to do it. I mean, I'm going to do it. I'm going to make a way for young people to get involved. And he was just clear, and I quote him, I heard what he was talking about then, and I just jumped on the bandwagon, and I've been riding ever since, and you know, I believe in his vision.
Oh, okay. I mean, that says a lot about you, knowing firsthand. See, people like the Johnny come lately and jump on the bandwagon, but like you said, you came, he was fresh out of college and stuff like that, and you seen something in our mayor that people just saying now, so that take a keen eye. And then to go up against political powerhouses such as the names we just said before, like Sharp James and them stuff like that. So, you knew it was a long uphill battle, but you walked that walk with him.
Yeah, but you know, it's, you know, of course Sharp is who he is. Sharp James is Sharp James. But he comes from a legacy of power hitters. His father is Emery Baraka Jr.
Yeah.
Emery Baraka, excuse me. And
rest Amira, in peace, Emery Baraka.
Yes, and his mother, Amira Baraka. So he comes from good stop, so he was prepared for it. Okay. So I'm just happy to be on the right ticket.
Yeah. Yes. One thing I like about you, Sue, I like to call you everybody's big brother. You know what I'm saying? You everybody's big brother. Like, you the type of, you's the go-to man. Like, you know what I'm saying? People got a, you know what I'm saying, a social issue, a problem or something like that. People need, you was very informational. Through all my life, I knew you. You know what I'm saying? Where did that come from? Like,
That's a good question. I think it's just having a love for your people, just wanting to really just do the right thing. You know, even though we do what we do in the streets, and we be a part of different things, but in your heart, you just want to do the right thing. And I just surrounded myself around good people all the time. Even when I was doing my nonsense out there, I just surrounded myself around good people, and I learned from good people. And it just flows out to the brothers that was around me. You know, I just stayed involved and just did what I had to do.
Right. So good people. It's good people. And you definitely is the poster person for good people. You know what I'm saying? I never hear you say a bad person about nobody. You know what I'm saying? Even if you wanted to, I never heard you say a bad person. And that is very, very commendable in the city of North. You know what I'm saying? Because you're not too many people that always on the positive. I've never seen you in a negative vibe. You know what I'm saying? I know we have our ups and downs, but you always stay positive, man. And that rubbed off to a lot of people. You know you influence a lot of people watching you without you even knowing it. Do you know that?
Well, I would like to think so anyway. But I don't press around like I just always been positive. I mean, I did some negative things in my life. You know, I'm not the angel.
Right.
I mean, I have did some things that I wasn't proud of, but all those things that I did shaped me to the person I am today. I mean, so I do have those trials and errors that I went through, in the past to look back on and say, wow, like you really changed. Like, you're doing some things now. I got a strong family around me that's always rooting for me, encouraged me to do good. I got a loving, supportive family, and just good friends.
Good friends.
Yeah. And I believe in God. I believe in God. So
definitely.
That helps.
That helps. You hear that? You hear that from the big bruh. You know what I'm saying? You got to be spiritually aware. You got to be spiritually conscious. Because it's a lot of people out here, like, the way this world going now, like, ain't like before, is it?
No, it's different. I mean, people today, it appears that people just don't have no regards for life, like, no love or nothing. It's just, everybody just walk around with post-traumatic stress there. Like, it's like no regard for human life at all. That's how I appear. But that's really not the case. There's a great deal of people out there that really love life, love people, and have regard for life. But we shine light on the negative more than we do on the positive. So it appeared that way. But there's a lot of people out there that really care, that's really striving to make a difference in everything. They're trying to, do the right thing for us.
Yeah. So what's the difference, coming from you, your insight, what's the difference from North back in the day and North now, as you see it? Like you said, we all did, we all ain't no saints. We all did some things that we not, proud of. But even if even though we all had our faults and we all did some things, but it was always conscious and it was always, sensible people. Even if they wasn't doing the right thing, it was sensible people around.
Well, I mean, there's a number of things. I mean, there's a whole host of things that's different. But I think the primary difference now is lack of resources and dissemination of resources and lack of culture. I mean, when you don't have culture, you just have chaos. Right. So I think that's the biggest difference. It's a disconnect. Back when we were growing up, we always had the big dudes that was hanging in the projects. Fred Murphy's, guys that's coming up in the projects, you always say, hey man, you can't, don't do that. I mean, you're doing that wrong. Play sports with us, or if we can't beat them in sports, they just chase us. It was like a different day. Today, there's no connect at all. There's no connect to young people, to old people. there's no relationships.
So you're saying the generation gap is far in between.
Absolutely.
It was like you were saying, like this is what you were saying when we were growing up in the projects. We played with the older guys.
Right.
You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? I don't even want to play with these little dudes now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
like older guys, like, we play, they interact with us.
Yeah.
So, you know what I'm saying? So what you're saying, it's a generational gap and it's a cultural divide.
Right, right. Not only do we don't want to play with them, we don't want to talk to them. Like, it's no communication. You know what I mean? Like, nobody even talking to the young people. You know, we walk around like we really afraid of them. These are our kids. These are our little brothers.
Yes.
Like, these people got marshes. They didn't fall out of the sky. Like, these are our family members. You know what I mean? So, like, when you start talking to them, like, you know, Hayes Home, we do what we call the Hayes Home reunion every year. The people that grew up in the project, we come together, we celebrate the history of the project. But then what I find when I go to the project, some of the kids that I come in, I see, like some of the guys I grew up with, they kids are the same kids that was in high school when Raz was the principal. Mm-hmm. The kids that was knuckleheads, then I'm like, that's your son? Like, I remember him when Raz was working in the high school.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So there's a connect. So it brings families together. You know what I mean? And then like when you see some of these kids in the street, like, yo, bro, don't do that. I know your father. Right. I just saw you at the Hayes Home. You was at the Hayes Home cooking. So you know, it brings people together. You don't have that no more. Like, there's no connection. Like, people don't know each other. But we act like we don't know each other. But we really do.
We really do.
We really do. Like, these are our kids. Like, we know each other. You know, somebody just got to just step forward and just be willing to talk to them, you know.
You so we got to take it back to the day, because y'all did told us. Y'all told, don't do that.
Right.
I mean, don't go around that corner. Or, yo, stop doing that.
Right.
Matter of fact, move up in front of the building. Help the old lady out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Matter of fact, you stand out here, help the old lady. Y'all did that.
Bro, I'm going to look back in the project. I don't talk too much about the negative. When we was out there hustling, I remember the lady, you wouldn't dare selling no weed, no drugs in front of nobody, mother or grandma, when they come in the building. I mean, we used to be in front of the building, and Miss Asley or Miss Wartlow or Miss Moore, I mean, Miss Baker, somebody come, brother, everything just stopped. You shut down and don't nothing move until they upstairs.
Right.
You know what I mean? Then you go back to your nonsense. You know what
right.
I mean? Now, these guys, they walk right past you, push your mother to the side, and you know, hand to hand right in front of your mother and your father. Like, it's no respect. And the guys standing, they see them doing it, and nobody don't say nothing to them.
And even the older guys see them doing it. Don't say, the older guys don't say, man.
Today, the older guys is the lookout for the kids. You know what I mean? That's crazy. You know what I mean? That's crazy. You got, you know what I mean? My wife and I had a hot dog truck down South Borders years ago. And I remember to this day, it was a little kid. He had been between 9 and 11 years old. He used to come to my truck every day. My wife used to be like, sometimes, look at this kid. This kid was 9, 11 years old, come with a stack of money, a wad of money. Mm-hmm. Telling him to feed his mother and his father. Like, give my mother and father and this person whatever they want. He was taking care of the family. I mean, mother just standing like a little kid and like give her a hot dog or give her a bag of chips, and the kid was paying for it.
Man.
I mean, it's crazy. I mean, you know, people. That's reality.
Hey, so
that's reality.
Did you had a hot dog truck down in San Borton?
Yeah.
Coming from Hayes Home, how
yes,
did
yes.
you just went down to San Borton? That shows. A man of respect.
Yeah.
You went where you wanted, Norgo.
Well, most of the people that were living in projects, they migrated from Hayes Home to Stella, right? They moved over there.
Right.
You know what I mean? But, actually, my wife had it, you know, be totally honest. It was her idea. You know?
Strong shout out to Sutan wife.
Yeah, it was her idea to go down South Portland and do the hot dog thing. She just, well, if there's some money to be made, she was going there. She was going to get it. So I just really followed her. But
right.
That was her brainchild, and she went down to support her on that effort.
Around what year this was, you think?
2000, 2001, maybe.
That's when Seth Boyd.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? You ain't never had no problems.
Yeah. Well, long you had families down in Seth Boyd, don't get it twisted.
Seth Boyd
always been Seth Boyd.
Right.
You know, but, you know, I think, you know, you carry yourself with respect. People treat you with respect. So I was able to go in there. That's another thing too. I'm one of the few people. I ain't gonna say few people. Back then, we could go wherever we wanted to go. Now you can't go one block over. You got guys that live on lines that can't go to Chancellor Avenue.
Right.
Or you know what I mean? So you're on Burger Street, can't go up to Glen Place.
And that's what I can't.